So thank you very much. I'm from the Chesapeake Biological Laboratory, which is part of the University of Maryland Center for Environmental Science. And I'm going to be talking today about our project, Chesapeake Dolphin Watch. Now, has anyone heard me speak about this before? Okay, sister. And how many of you have the Chesapeake Dolphin Watch app? Oh, brilliant, okay. I hope by tonight this will be the whole room. Okay, I'm gonna check it out. Chesapeake Dolphin Watch, you can get it on Android or on Google Play, or you can go to the website, www.chesapeakedolphinwatch.org. So I'm gonna tell you a bit today about the project, which involves both your help in understanding what the dolphins are doing in the bay, and also the use of sound to listen to the dolphins and see what they're telling us. So what I'm going to do is introduce a little bit about the research that we've been doing, how the project got started, which was back in 2017. I'm going to talk about the acoustic analysis that we've been doing of dolphin calls, and then I'm going to talk specifically about the work where we're engaging the public to use them as our observation network to find out where the dolphins are going and what are they doing there. Now, I'm going to give you a little preview of the conclusion. So if you move to the next slide, here are the take-home messages. So for any of you, by the end of the hour, if you glazed over and you're in your donut stupor there, these are the take-home messages. So firstly, dolphins mainly occur in the bay from May to October. So it's a little early in the season. Right now we've got a few sightings coming in, but once we hit May, it'll start to become more regular, and June, July, August are really key months. So if you are out on the water, those are the times to really, really looking for dolphins, because they are pretty common in the bay, and far more common than we had ever previously thought. When I talk about listening to the dolphins, you may not know, but dolphins actually have names, just like we do. And I'm going to talk a little bit about these names that we call signature whistles and how we're using that to track individual dolphins and find out where they're going. And then lastly, we were very excited to have a student last summer who was analyzing the dolphin sightings that the public had reported and seeing if we could understand not only where the dolphins are going, but why, and understand their relationship with environmental variables. And obviously the next step will be to actually look at it in relation to fish information as well, because they're most likely coming into the bay to feed. I will say nearly all the photos that I'm showing are from our dolphin watchers, so a huge thank you to anyone who's contributed photos to the project. So the first component is sound monitoring. Are you all aware that dolphins make sounds? How many of you have seen a dolphin, heard a dolphin? Excellent. So dolphins are very, very vocal. They are very chatty animals. They talk to each other frequently. And this is a great tool. So instead of having to put a tag on an animal or anything else that are more invasive, we can just put these underwater microphones that we call hydrophones in the water and just listen for those calls, and then therefore we can know what the dolphins are doing, and because those different calls mean different things. However, it is sometimes helpful to have a network, because these devices, these microphones, we can only detect dolphins over about a mile, and the Chesapeake Bay is huge. If we were going to put a hydrophone every mile, does anyone know how many we would need? It would be hundreds. It's a big place. So we really use the citizen science reporting of sightings to give us that bigger picture of what's going on throughout the whole bay. We go to the next slide. So the project started not actually with the Chesapeake Bay in mind. We actually had bought hydrophones as part of a project funded to look at the occurrence of marine mammals in the Maryland Wind Energy Area, which is off Ocean City, Maryland in the Atlantic Ocean. But before you put any electrical device in seawater, which of course is a stupid thing to do anyway, we tested it off our pier. So this is the Chesapeake Biological Lab that's in Solomons. It's near the mouth of the Patuxent River. And this cylinder here, and you can see here Amber and Leila, my two research assistants, are deploying off the piers and checking it was working and that it was recording effectively. But really, it was just to test the device. And what surprised us is back in 2015, we were actually getting dolphin detections. And as I asked about this further, there is a Maryland Department of Natural Resources respond to strandings. So if a live or dead animal is stranded, there's a hotline number that you can call, so you can 24/7, to report stranding. But on that number, only about 20 live regular dolphin sightings per year were being reported. So we knew that bottlenose dolphins are a natural part of the bay ecosystem, but they were considered very occasional visitors. They were not considered a regular inhabitant of the bay. And what we were detecting indicated that maybe that wasn't the case, that we were getting fairly frequent detections during the summer. Now, I'm just going to sidestep for a moment and tell you, just in case you are interested, about the Atlantic Offshore Wind Project. We go to the next slide. What I am going to do first is a little test here. Okay, so what type of animal is a dolphin?
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay. Everyone can read. Secondly, what species of dolphin am I talking about? Brilliant. Everyone can see it. Brilliant. Yes, so these are the same type of dolphins that you will see in the Baltimore Aquarium. They are fairly widespread. The work that I did for my PhD up in Scotland in the UK is the most northern resident population of bottlenose dolphins. The most southern resident population of bottlenose dolphins, does anyone know how far they extend? Where would you guess?
Australia?
Oh, close. A little bit further south, but nearby to that.
New Zealand.
Right, it's down the South Island of New Zealand. So they have a very far range. This weight and length range is very large because dolphins in colder water tend to be, you think, bigger or smaller than those in warmer water? They're bigger in colder water because they want a nice big body to create heat, generate that heat, and then a small surface area over which to use it. These are actually dolphins in the bay, so these are our sort of mid-range size bottlenose dolphins. They're much more elegant than our chubby Scotland dolphins. They're kind of big. I mean, people are sometimes surprised. I often hear the comment that people see them either from land or from a boat. Wow, they were bigger than I thought. But these are fairly large animals, and do remember that often you're only seeing a portion of them when they surface. So if you try and catch one, they're fairly large, but please don't, as I say, they are protected. So the next slide, they can live up to 50 years. Now, there isn't yet a project that has actually monitored for 50 years, so this is still a little bit of a guess, but we do have projects now that have been going on for at least 30 years. So we do know in the wild that these animals can live for at least 30 years. And they feed on a variety of fish and squid. They are generalists. They will feed on different things from menhaden to striped bass. In Scotland, they love the salmon. But some dolphins will have specializations. I mean, just like me, you know, I might say I really like steak and someone says I really love shrimp. Like, and dolphins are the same. They'll have preferences. And something that we've seen is particularly if a mother has a particular feeding strategy. An example in Australia is where they put sponges on their noses and they feed down in the bottom and that sponge helps protect their nose. And some dolphins do that, and if a mother does it, usually her young will do it, but other dolphins may have a very different feeding strategy, so there are differences among dolphins too. They're generally found in groups. You can sometimes see a single animal, but you may also see them in groups of 10, 20, or even up to 100. We were astounded when we began this project. We, for the public, just put group sizes of less than 5, more than 5 to 10, or more than 10. And then we sort of get people saying, well, I'm seeing 50, or I'm seeing over 50. And at first, really? And then we started seeing pictures and video, and it's like, there really are huge group sizes in the bay, so we actually have to increase those categories. And that is unusual, because usually big groups like that are seen offshore, they're less chemistry, dolphins are in smaller groups, so that was kind of interesting to see that. But as we'll talk about, just because they look like they're separated, it doesn't mean they are. They use sound, and sound can travel quite far in the water. So even if it looks like, oh, there's a group over here, there's a group over here, there's a group over here, they may all be talking to each other and be in communication. Now they're well known, these dolphins are well known for bow riding boats, leaping, very acrobatic. They are definitely my favorites in terms of being able to watch them, they're just so fun to watch. But please do just remember they are a protected species. Do not feed them. Keep your distance. Let the dolphins approach you if you are in a boat, because this is a federally protected species. Okay, so if we go to the next one. Now, I could do my dolphin impression, but I'm going to pass to the technology works. Okay, so we'll see if we can play. So I'm going to play some dolphin sounds from Maryland dolphins. It's the joys of getting older. But dolphins can actually hear up to over 130 kilohertz. So this would be going way, way, way up beyond the screen in terms of what they can hear and the sounds that they produce. So one sound that we're hearing were like clicks. These are these vertical lines, and as I say, they will extend right up to 130 kilohertz. The second sound that we were hearing were the whistles. These are these squiggly lines here, so this is time along the bottom. So these green lines are showing you the whistles. So we've got clicks, which are the echolocation sounds that we think they're using for navigation and feeding, because it's hard to see underwater. And then these whistles are then chatting to each other and giving the gossip. What do you think this noise at the bottom was? What was the other sound you heard? Okay, louder, I'm in the 40s category. You might hear some water noise. What else? Boats. Yeah. So and it was interesting because I was talking to a physicist about this recently. It's usually not just so much the engine, but it's the cavitation of the propeller. Essentially, as it's turning, it's vaporizing out water, and the air bubbles as they explode create sound. And so you've got this low frequency sound. Usually, it's below 2 kilohertz. So it's below quite a lot of the sounds that the dolphins are making. You've got the chugga 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 chugga. You've got that boat noise. So those are the things you are hearing. Now, do you remember why is sound such a great sensory function for dolphins? Anyone know how does it travel underwater?
Quick.
Really fast. So how many times faster do you think sound travels in water than in air?
Four.
Oh, very close. Very close. It's near 5. So in air, it travels about 300 meters per second, and in water, it travels about 1500 meters per second. So, and that's because you've got particles closer together in a liquid than in gas. So it means the sound is traveling faster and traveling further. So if dolphins want to talk to each other over several miles, then they're much better off doing that with sounds than they are trying to do anything visually. So we go to the next slide. So this is the offshore project, just in case you're interested. So this is the lease area that was auctioned by the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management, which is a federal agency that controls the leases outside state waters, so beyond 3 miles. And this is about 13 to 23 miles off Ocean City. And the lease was awarded to U.S. Wind, and we were funded by the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management and by the state, Maryland Department of Natural Resources, and Maryland Energy Administration to find out what marine mammals were in the area right now before anything is built. There is no wind farm at the moment. It's just open water. What is there so that we can help to create, if they do construct a wind farm, we do it in a way that minimizes the impact to these protected species and, if necessary, mitigate any effects. So we were monitoring for 3 years, from 2014 to 2017, with these underwater microphones to listen for the sounds of the dolphins and whales. And then we did it again in the summer of 2018-2019. And if you go to the next slide, these little circles here show all the devices that we put in the water. And it's always good to say, we're throwing electrical devices in salt water, it's good to have redundancy. So we made sure that we had plenty of recorders in the wind energy area to capture what was going through the region, but we also wanted to capture outside, because this is just a pretend boundary. For sound, this is no boundary at all. If they create noise here, it will spread out. So we wanted to check where were the whales migrating, where were the dolphins occurring, and have all of that baseline information before any wind farm construction occurs. We're going to the next slide. I'm going to show you some results. Now, another reason that we had all of these hydrophones was so instead of just detecting the whales, we could actually localize them. Whales produce very low frequency sounds that travel many miles. In fact, some of the really, really large whales, like the fin whale, produces a 20 hertz pulse that can travel hundreds of miles. So I'm just going to show you for now the critically endangered right whale. Sadly, there's only about 400 animals left, so they are in real trouble. And if we look at each of these months, we can see where you see the red circles, those are our devices, but where you see the other colors, those are the whale calls. And you can see during the summer, basically from sort of May to October, there's barely anything there. So the whales are mainly in their feeding ground during the summer, which is further north. But during November to March, they're migrating through the Maryland area, going south to their breeding ground, and then they go back north again to the foraging ground. And they're definitely within the wind energy area, and they're offshore of it. And sadly, this area is also where there's a lot of shipping traffic. So one of the threats to whales has been that, unfortunately, they get killed in ship strikes, and they also get entangled in fishing gear. So through having collected this data, the Bureau of Ocean Energy Management has prohibited pile driving, which is the loudest component of construction, to occur between November and April. So we're very pleased that this information is being used by the federal agency, the regulator, to try and avoid disruption of this critically endangered whale during its important migration period. Go to the next slide. Now we're going to get the little guys. We've got bottlenose dolphins, common dolphins, and harbor porpoises. So bear in mind, these are still off our waters, off Maryland. This is off the Atlantic coast. We've got bottlenose dolphins. Has anyone seen them off Ocean City, bottlenose dolphins? Yeah, excellent. And we're going to hear soon that some of those that you see in Ocean City can come into the bay too. So bottlenose dolphins off Ocean City are most common in the summer months from May to October. But offshore, we do also get common dolphins, and they're fairly common during the late winter and into the spring. And then harbor porpoise, has anyone seen a harbor porpoise? They're the small ones, excellent. So they're smaller than the bottlenose dolphin, they're only about 4 feet long. They've got, instead of the sickle-shaped fin, they've got a little triangular fin. They don't bow ride, they're usually pretty shy, but they do occur at the mouth of the bay, so if you do go right down to the mouth or out, particularly during more winter months, then you can see little harbor porpoises. Okay, if we go to the next slide, we're going to head back into the bay now. So where I was talking about offshore was over here. That's it. Of course, this is all totally connected as far as the dolphins are concerned with the bay. And we initially started, say, our lab is here. This is where we had a hydrophone. And then we also put one in the Potomac River. And then we've had sites in the upper bay as well. These devices are logging dolphin clicks and give us a relatively easy way to determine when dolphins are present. So we're going to the next slide. I'm going to show you some of those results. Now, it's always amazing. Biology is tricky because it's usually not easily repeats it. So for example, on one of my projects, I work with an engineer and we're trying to get look at fish behavior. And he said, well, if you do it 20 times, don't you get the same answer? And I said, no, because every time you do it with a different fish, they do something different. For example, we had a little Houdini who managed to get out of the net. We had another one who just sat on the bottom, wouldn't do anything. Biology is hard, and they're all individuals. So we were really surprised with our results from the Potomac River. This is showing 2016-2018, and we're just now we're finishing 2019 to add to this. But it's very consistent. Any way you see these lines above zero means dolphins were present on that day. These are the number of hours per day that we had detections, and this is time from mid-May through to November. And basically, these are all above zero from early June, with just an occasional here, right until basically mid-September. So dolphins are occurring in the Potomac River almost every day, and that's been consistent for, and as I say, we're finding the same thing for 2019, for 3 to 4 years now. So as I say, we're really trying to change that sort of paradigm. Oh, dolphins are only an occasional visitor to the bay. Well, I say, no, actually, they're here every day during the summer. This is just live happening. This one actually picked up the hydrophone in the autumn, but it stopped recording for whatever reason. So there we go, that's electronics for you. Next slide, please. So this is in the Patuxent River. You can see here that we have much lower detection. So really interestingly, the whole place that started this project wasn't actually the area that dolphins were most common. We were like, wow, there's dolphins in the bay. And then say we put the hydrophone in the Potomac, we're like, whoa, there's a lot of dolphins going into the bay. So this just shows we're getting regular from June to September. It's not every day in the Patuxent, but we're seeing it sort of several times per week. So right now, from that, we're sort of getting the picture that, oh, well, the Potomac is a little further south, and maybe the dolphins are spending more time further south and just a little less frequently further north. So if we go to the next slide, I thought, well, are there any other patterns? So we looked at time of day, and in the two regions, we thought basically, even though it's less for the Patuxent than the Potomac, definitely more detections at night. That could be they're echolocating more because they can't see, so they're having to use their sound at night, but it could also be they're just more active and doing more at night. If we go to the next slide, this is in relation to tidal states, and I think it's really interesting. We were seeing this fairly big peak on the flood tides as the tide is coming in, so maybe that's related to them trying to feed and in some way coming in and exploiting that to catch fish. And then similarly, so this is tidal state where this is high water, so this is mid-flood and this is mid-ebb, so they seem to like it when the currents are stronger and be more prevalent. We're going to the next slide. Having looked at the Potomac and the Patuxent in collaboration with the Smithsonian Environmental Research Center, we looked at the Rogue River. So this is now up into the upper bay, sort of nearer where we are now. And interestingly, we're showing a similar pattern, but it was a little different in that they're mainly detected in June to July, and sometimes they're not present. But when they are present, they often they were there for a little while. So it began to make us say, well, what are the dolphins doing in the upper bay? How is that different to what they were doing in the lower bay? Go to the next slide. And to sort of think about how dolphins are moving, it can really help if you know who they are. And this is where I mentioned dolphins have names, these signature whistles. Now, unlike us, where our parents give us a name, dolphins actually develop their own name within the first few months of life. So if your child hates the name you gave them, just tell them they need to be a dolphin. And these are important because they're calling to each other. So if you've got these different groups and then they meet, they're calling to each other and saying who they are. And dolphins aren't like some of the other species, like killer whales, where they have a family group and they stay in that group. Almost dolphin groups are much more fluid. So they might have a few dolphins that they hang around with. They've got some of their best friends, but then they'll also have other friends that they'll meet up with. And so they're talking to each other frequently because they're making these different acquaintances, and they've got this ability to maintain group cohesion by talking to each other But it's a much more fluid system. They're not always staying in the same group. Sometimes you might have a male group come along, but a lot of times you'll have males and females mixing too. So we go to the next slide. I'm going to play, let's see if this will cooperate too. This is an example of a dolphin signature whistle. So this is one dolphin. So what we use to define a signature whistle is they say it more than once within a certain time frame, and we call this a bout. So the whistle is more than a certain length, and there's a certain time between them. So if any of you watch Big Bang, it's like when Sheldon goes, penny, penny, penny. That's kind of how dolphins call it. They are very distinct, and they will produce these about half of the time. So they're calling their name fairly frequently as part of their conversation. And unlike us, where if I call my mum and I just say, hi mum, it's me, I don't even need to say it's Helen. She can tell from my voice it's me. But dolphins can't do that, probably because of the way the sound is propagating underwater. The shape of this whistle, this what we call contour, contains all the information. So that's really key to them. So we get to the next slide. So the advantage of this is by identifying the signature whistles and having long-term recordings and at multiple sites, is then we can see, well, we detected this dolphin at one time, and then we detected it again another time, and then we detected it somewhere else. So we can follow the dolphin again without having to tag them or do anything invasive. If we go to the next slide, my poor students have gone through many thousands of hours of recordings looking at this. We do use some automated detectors, but we also have to manually verify it. And right now we have one of the largest catalogs in the world of signature whistles. This is very new research. Mostly it's been done in captivity, so this is one of the very rare cases where in the wild dolphin signature whistles are being catalogued. And here I'm showing you in terms of how many recordings we have, how many we've analyzed, and how many signature whistles we've identified. These two are for the offshore sites. This one is off Ocean City, this is in the wind energy area, and this one is in the Rogue River. And right now, we have over 1,000 detected off Ocean City, so over 1,000 different dolphins, and that's probably an underestimate of the total. And then we have 20 from the Rogue River. Now, in the Rogue River, it is fairly shallow, so we did sometimes have difficulty because we had a lot of wave noise, even bird noise and frog noise and other things that sometimes made it difficult to detect the whistles. But of these 20, two of them were detected offshore. So although NOAA, the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, classifies the dolphin populations whereby the dolphins off the Atlantic side of Maryland are considered part of the northern migratory stock, and the dolphins that could come in the bay are part of the southern migratory stock, we know that's not as simple as that, because dolphins off Ocean City will come into the bay. So as we continue this research, we're hoping that this will help inform further how these different populations are moving, because it's been based so far on a very small number of satellite tracks individuals that may not have been representative of the population that numbers over 1,000. So this has been really exciting to be able to track these dolphins. If we go to the next slide, this is showing you all the dolphins that we detected more than once. We haven't yet named over 100 of them, we just get the numbers. But if we look over time, so we've got from 2016 to 2019, wherever you see these circles, this is when the dolphin's signature whistle was detected, and you can see some of these lines are quite long. So actually we had up to 689 days between detections. So a dolphin that occurred in the area over a year ago, two years ago, was detected again. So these animals probably have preferred areas that they're going to, that we were capturing. As I mentioned, two of them in the Rogue River also occurred in the Atlantic Ocean. So we're just starting to build this picture of where these individual dolphins are going. We go to the next slide. So, as I say, the limitation, although acoustics is wonderful, we only have about a mile detection range. So really, it's like, even if the dolphins are going up and down the bay, what's the chances that they go close enough to our one microphone in the very river that we detected? So we really needed to have this bigger observation network to really understand what was going on throughout the whole bay. And in my work in Scotland, I had a volunteer group, and we would train the volunteers, and they would go out and be dedicated watchers at the weekend. But we now live in a world where, with mobile devices, you've effectively got a GPS device right on you that you can easily just click, and we have a location and time. So we decided that this was really the way to go forward. We initially developed it as a website, and then made it into an app for Android and iPhones. Over the course of the last 2.5 years, we now have 5,500 users of the app, and we have more than 1,000 dolphin sightings verified. I will say that's verified. If we actually told it, the actual number of dolphin sightings reported is about 3,000 now. It was launched in June 2017. We were in mad panic trying to get it out before the summer season. So we managed to capture some of the summer of 2017, and it's been running since then. So we go to the next one. For those of you who don't have it, as I say, it's a website and an application. It allows you to view and report sightings. So if you're like, oh, I wonder where dolphins have been seen the last week, I'm going to be going out this weekend, then you can see where the sightings are. If you go to the next slide, I'll just walk you through some of the things that we updated it with last year that have been really great. So if you are competitive or you to see yours, we now have the feature, yes, this did come back from feedback, I want to see where my dolphin sighting is. Everyone else's dolphin sightings are blue, but yours is pink. You can include a description of your sighting, and please do, because when we verify, we're looking at that description as a way to make sure you didn't just press the button by mistake. I think most people know what a dolphin looks like, so we're less worried that you didn't know it was a dolphin, or more just, did you really mean to make this sighting? It auto-populates with the current date time that long, but you can alter any of that. If you're on your vessel and you have your GPS on the vessel, and you're like, oh, I think the dolphins are here, you can either enter that, or you can, when you make the sighting, you can tap on the map and put in, you know, where you think it was. We've got these group categories for how many dolphins you think there were. If you have any photos or video that you'd like to share, you can upload those too. And that's been very helpful so that we can make sure, yes, it was definitely a bottlenose dolphin. That makes the verification process very fast. And we did just last year start where we can put a microphone symbol. So where we have made dolphin detections from our hydrophones, we can put a little symbol and you can then click on that and hear the dolphins that were recorded. So you can look at that too. If we go to the next slide. Not everyone is comfortable with this, so you know this is up to you, but we do require that anyone who goes into the app registers. The reason for this is it is a federally protected species. If you make a sighting, this is a research project. This is not just, it's fun to collect dolphin sightings. We want to be able to contact you and just be able to say, hey, can you just give us a little bit more information about your sighting? If you put in a description, we may not need to, but if you didn't put in any other information, then we'll just be like, hey, can you just confirm that you really meant to make this dolphin sighting? Because we don't want to analyze anything that we haven't been able to verify was definitely a dolphin sighting. On the next slide, you will also have to go through just a very short slideshow of things about don't feed the dolphins, keep your distance and that thing, which again came from feedback from NOAA. They didn't want us encouraging people to harass dolphins, so just making sure you keep that in mind and the numbers are there if you do see any stranded animals. We do not directly deal with stranded animals. These are the numbers of the people who will be able to respond to that. And you can use the filter here. Initially, you didn't need it, but now that we've got several years' data, you can look at today, the last week, the last month, or any of the years to see where the dolphin sightings are. We get to the next slide. So if you do make a sighting, you can just click on the map or say use my current location. If for any reason, like I know I've had the same thing. You see a dolphin and you're like, oh my goodness, I don't have a camera. Oh, I want to put it in the app. What should I do first? It's fine if you put it in the app afterwards. Don't worry about it. If you do click it in the app and then you're like, oh, I want to add more information because this happened or that happened, you can always click on the button View My Sightings and you can add it, edit or add any information that you want to afterwards. Since we are mostly volunteer run, the person who verifies the sighting, it can usually take about a week. So don't worry, if you put it in, it will show up on the map right away, but we won't necessarily be verifying it that day. It may still take us a few days to get through them, particularly if it's June, July time when we're getting a lot of sightings. When your sighting is verified, then you will see, if you go to View My Sightings, you'll see it's confirmed. Okay, the next slide. A huge thank you to anyone who has reported their dolphin sightings. We were just amazed. I mean, I've taken a lot of dolphin pictures and I was like, wow, I should hire these people because they take great pictures of the dolphins. Dolphins are new, fast, they're pretty hard. You're like, oh, I got another wave. Oh, I just got the splash. This is one of the few pictures that we have of a dolphin with a fish, although we do think that he is a feed. Does anyone know what fish that is? It's pretty small there. So that is a shad, which was interesting because we only have very limited diet information because we usually get it from stranded animals, and many of those stranded animals have been sick and they have empty stomachs. So we knew that they fed on a variety of species, but a lot of times even when they're feeding, you're not seeing the fish. So that's one of the few pictures we have with a fish. If you do see a dolphin and you do see it with a fish, we would love to hear about it to find out more about what they're feeding. Slide. I'm going to show you, let's see if this works. I'm going to show you, can you click on the video? So feeding is not all that the dolphins are doing here. There's a bit of communing going on as well. They have a gestation period of 12 months. So if you see babies in the bay, you know what else they're doing in the bay. And I'm going to show you one of our rare videos of a baby. And they are so fun. This is a fairly young one, and I don't know if you heard on the news last year, our collaborators at Georgetown University actually saw a live bird in the bay for the first time. It's very, very rare to see a live bird. In fact, the PI of the project, Professor Janet Mann, was complaining afterwards. That was one of the few days she wasn't on the boat in her 30-year career. She had never seen a live bird, but her students did. So they're just wonderful. When they're born, of course, they meet their mammals. They have to come up and breathe. But they're also babies, and they don't quite know what they're doing. So they're learning to swim and breathe at the same time. And whereas the adults sort of come up elegantly, you can see the little babies sort of doing it like, whoa, okay, whoa, okay. So they're such fun to watch if you see a young one. Do you want to show that video again?
Sure.
I love this one. And it's actually very hard because usually the mother will usually try and stay between you and the baby. If you are in it, they are very protective. So this is really unusual. And this one is a little off to the side. That must be quite an experienced mother. This is a second child or more, and yeah, sure. So in the next video, this is one in the Great White Conifer River, and this is a kayaker, and we have quite a lot of kayakers having this kind of experience. But what I love about this, I don't know if you can hear, but they're also whistling. So what they're saying is, hey, there's a kayaker. Have you seen this? Like, yeah. It is very unusual to have an in-air video like that and you can hear them whistling. That was really cool. So they were obviously really if we get to the next video, now they will also leap, and so usually when you see them leaping, that's not actually feeding behavior, that's socializing. And it can be quite aggressive. Like these two are they're probably males and they're basically having a bit of a tussle. And what they will sometimes do is sometimes you'll see one leap and you'll be like, oh, and then there's actually another one trying to headbutt it. So if you see marks on a dolphin, it's quite odd. They can be quite physical with each other. If we go to the next video, this is one from 2019, which I love. Dana Scanlon actually contacted me before the project started.
Thank you.
launched that app, she had contacted me saying, I've had a dolphin sighting, have you got this video? And it was on her sailing boat, and it's going like this, and you're watching the dolphin going, oh my goodness, thank goodness he's sick. But she was so excited, and that was back in early 2017. So I was really excited when she sent this last year. It's like, I know you still got your enthusiasm. You can hear all the people on the boat are still so excited. And they are such fun to watch. I do have to be careful what videos I select because people get so excited sometimes we have to bleep out the names. this one was family rated, so it'll be okay. So if we go to the next slide. So my student last summer was mapping out the sightings. Oh, it sort of looks a little white there. There is actually an outline of the land, but it's kind of got bleached out on the screen. If you play the video, so it's showing from the launch of the app in late 2017, it's showing you weekly the sightings. And unfortunately, you can't see the land very well, but we've got the pointing here, right? This is, we've got the Potomac down here, the Tucson up here. Try the next one. So we've got 2018. Okay. Well, this one at least is color coded. So here, we're going to see in green are lower bay dolphins, yellow is middle bay, and purple is upper bay. So even if you can't see the land, it gives you an impression. And what you're seeing, of course, is June, July is when we get a lot of upper bay, and then from August time, it's getting much further down. So what we think is happening, if you play that video again, is we're getting really exploratory trips in the beginning where they are going up the bay, but they want to hang out there, and then in June, July, they're really being here a lot, as well as the middle bay, and then into winter, it's sort of autumn, it's going back down. Now, this population, we think, and I say, it is interesting because we're sort of relearning what the population is doing, but we think in what they're doing in autumn is they're going further south and spending the winter off North Carolina. So that's what we think they're doing. They winter in North Carolina, then during the summer they're up here in the bay and they're off the Atlantic side, and then they go back down south again. So we go to the next slide. I just put these in case the videos didn't work, so that this gives you sort of the whole year. Now, obviously, we had publicized the app a lot more, so we had a lot more users by 2018. So it's not just that there were more dolphins. If we go to the next slide, we can now look at seasonal occurrence. And we're just sort of finishing the analysis for 2019, but up to this, on this graph, it's showing up to the end of June. So what's really obvious is the very seasonal pattern where, and that is 4th of July, is end of June, early July is really a peak time for the dolphins. And you'll see, it's been, even though the lines are different because we might have different numbers of users, that pattern has been consistent across years, which is really interesting. So that does seem to me they're coming in at that time, and you know, why is that? Because they're following certain fish, or they're doing certain things. I mean, certainly the bay does seem to be an important nursery area, so it is a breeding ground as well as a feeding ground. If we go to the next slide, so this is just breaking it down for you by month, so you can see those sightings by month. If we go to the next slide, and that goes through to October. So that pattern that I was mentioning. So by October, the upper bay sightings are much more rare. Then the next slide. So having identified the seasonal pattern the student and I had last summer, then combine the sightings with environmental data. So we know that the dolphins are probably following fish, but as I say, they're generalists. So it's very hard to know, well, what fish specifically are they following, and it may be that there isn't, that it's just sort of generally, is there sort of more food available? But it could also be, is it a temperature cue? So that temperature cue could be affecting the fish, but it could also be related to, say, if they're giving birth, that they're going at a certain time. So she was using, we have a wonderful observing system in the bay for water quality measurements, things like temperature, salinity, dissolved oxygen that is freely available from NOAA and American Department of Natural Resources. So we use that to understand what was going on in terms of the environmental conditions in the bay when the dolphins were there. So we're in the next slide. So Lauren was looking at the weekly number of dolphin sightings, and to account for the fact that we have different users depending on the time of year and between years, we actually have Google Analytics will tell us how many people logged into the app, so we can use that as some measure of effort. So for example, 4th of July weekend is always our biggest number of users because lots of people are out in the water, and this allows us to sort of take that into account, so we're normalizing the sightings by the number of users at that time. And we fit a statistical model where this is our response and these are our predictive variables. So we had tidal phase as spring or neap, the temperature, salinity, and dissolved oxygen to see if those were significantly related to dolphin occurrence. And we were really surprised because given that they are generalists on fish, I was thinking, are these more physical variables really going to show us much of a pattern? But they certainly do. You can see these yellow dots are the raw data, and then the line is the fit for the model. And you can see a very strong temperature relationship. Now that's obviously going to be partly because of that seasonal cycle. But it also sort of indicates that maybe temperature is serving as part of the cue. Salinity had a relationship, but it was less strong than temperature. And the other one that was very significant was spring tides. Dolphins seem to be around more in the bay when there are spring tides. And that was interesting because we'd also seen that pattern in the acoustic data of more dolphins being there when it was mid-flood or mid-ebb. So this idea of stronger currents. So it may be that those currents are what they're using to help them catch the fish in some way. This is just the model for the middle bay area. We actually did models for the lower, middle, and upper bay, and we're just finalizing those now. Next slide. And we also tested the model. So the model was trained with 2 years of data from June 2017 to June 2019. And then what we did is said, okay, so given the temperature, salinity, and tidal phase each week, in July to October, what would the model predict occurrence of dolphins would be? That's this orange line. And then what were the actual number of sightings that we had reported? That's the blue line. And what's amazing is you can see that these lines are actually very close. So our ability to predict the occurrence of dolphins based on those environmental variables is actually pretty good. And what we want to do is see how well that fits this year as well, in 2020. So we were really excited that this first modeling effort seems to be working out fairly well to understand how dolphins are coming into the bay and why. Next slide. So next step. So if you want, we have put a summary of our findings on our website, empathies.eu/dolphinwatch. So if you want, it's a little PDF you can download that talks about research and what we've found so far. Now, I do want to emphasize, people reporting sightings, people often just think that's part of an outreach project. This really is part of the scientific research. We are just completing a scientific paper on that seasonal distribution and the environmental model that we submitted to a scientific journal. So this has been really, really important. No one had done any kind of survey like that before. This is the first time information on dolphins throughout the bay has ever been recorded in this way. And we're really excited to have two students now contributing to this project. I have a PhD student who's focusing on the sound recordings. If you noticed in those maps, we quite often had more sightings on the west side of the bay than the east. And we want to know, is that because there's more people reporting on the west than the east? And one way to verify that is to use the hydrophones, because they're recording all the time. So he is putting out recorders in the upper bay of King Island on the eastern side. So we'll be able to look at how that compares the Rhode Island side to the Kent Island side, and also what the ambient noise levels are, because off the west side of Kent Island is obviously right there near where the main channel is, and with increased shipping into Baltimore Port, we want to track, well, how does that increase the sound levels, and does that have any effects on these very critical species? And then Lauren, who did the work last year, she's now got a fellowship. She's going to be starting this summer to continue that research, understanding the ecology of Baltimore dolphins using the sighting data that we're getting from the public. So here at the last, many of these people have volunteered their time. This project has has run on a relative shoestring, and it's just a huge thank you to everyone who has contributed to the project, and to Smithsonian for contributing their recordings from their microphone. The funding for the app was from the Chesapeake Bay Trust, the track software, and the Chesapeake Biological Laboratory. And as I mentioned, the offshore work that we were doing was federally and state funded. Here's the last slide. And thank you very much for listening today. And please do take a look at the app and let us know if you see any dolphins this year.
Thank you.
About what distance do dolphins communicate across, and what range do you pick them up? And is that also affected by salinity?
Yeah, so the distance that we can detect them and the distance that they can detect each other is slightly different because it depends on the sensitivity of the device. So dolphin communication is probably on the order of 20 kilometers, which is over 10 miles. The whistles are set at lower frequency than the clicks, so the clicks are more, higher frequencies break down more quickly. So higher frequency stuff is for near, so this is when, as I say, they're trying to make sure that they know where they're going, they're not hitting things, and they're hunting a fish. But the whistles, where they're communicating with each other, so those are more in like the 3 to 8 kilohertz range, that can travel much further. Those low frequency sounds travel much longer distances. So yeah, you can, as I say, you can be seeing dolphins over there and over there, and they are chatting away to each other. Yeah.
And What's your detectable?
So for the clicks, it's about a mile detection range. For the whistles, it's hard because it depends on the location. So like the lower Potomac, where it's more open, we probably have a detection range not quite up 10 miles, but we could have it up to 10 miles. But in some, like if we put it up a river where it's shallow or it's bendy, it's going to be less. Yeah.
How does the fishing impact the truck from trolling for rockfish and stuff like that? Does that ever snag dolphins or anything like that? Or is there a problem with that?
So in Virginia, there have been regulations regarding the pound nets in relation to dolphins that has greatly reduced interactions. The main thing that has been an issue for dolphins, because they're pretty good, because they do use echolocation, they're generally better than whales about not getting entangled, but they monofilament gill nets have been a real issue because they don't seem to be able to detect that as well. As far as I'm aware, trawl nets haven't been.
I meant trolling, but rockfish, they put out 16 lines. It's a big, a lot of, and they're different depths. But they hear them and avoid them.
Yeah, I haven't heard of that happening. There's been relatively little bycatch in the bay in recent years. Yeah.
And anybody caught a dolphin trying to fish with me? Does dolphin ever go after fishing lures?
Well, I mean, I guess if there's a fish, they might try, but I haven't heard of one specifically being caught.
Right, okay.
And they're fairly smart.
That's it. No, that's what I mean. That's what I'm figuring.
Yeah, I mean, monofilament gill nets have been the main issue. Okay, let's start at the back.
Wonderful talk, thank you. I missed the first 10 minutes. I don't know if you covered, do you know how long this phenomenon has been going on? Do you feel like this has been going on for years and years, or that it's because of climate change, do we have any?
So there's certainly news articles from the 1800s that mention dolphins, although it's hard because they sometimes also call them porpoises. So I think the fact that dolphins have been in the bay is for a long time, but in the kinds of numbers and as regularly, certainly what we're hearing from the fishermen is they think it's more recent. They think, yes, they were there, but it seems to be increasing. The other thing to bear in mind is there was an epidemic of a morbilla virus in 2013 with massive numbers of dolphins dying. There were hundreds that were found dead, stranded off Maryland and Virginia. So in 2013, we think the population suffered quite a decline because of that disease, and the population is actually considered depleted. And so there is a NOAA take reduction team that focuses on the interactions with fisheries, so the idea of they don't want additional mortality when the population has suffered this decline. But we think because of that, the population over the last sort of 7 years has probably been increasing. So post this morbillivirus, it should now be increasing. And maybe as it's been increasing, the Chesapeake Bay has become one of the places that it's visiting more. Another question that I had is, well, did they just move from offshore into the bay? But we had our iPhones offshore in 2017, and that was our highest year of detection. So we had a lot of dolphins both outside the bay as well as inside the bay. So I don't think it was just a shift in distribution. I think perhaps we're seeing this increase in numbers, and then we're seeing an increase consequently of use of the bay.
So the range for this particular study, you said they wintered off of North Carolina, and they're in the bay in the summer months and off.
And then when
did they go up to like Maine?
They didn't go. The northern coast on migratory stock can go up as far as New Jersey, according to NOAA's definitions. The southern migratory stock only goes up as far as Virginia. But we're already seeing that isn't really matching with what we're finding, what Janet Mann at Georgetown is finding. So they are very mobile. I mean, when we see them going up and down the bay, I mean, they can go up and down the bay in a day easily, and then go up along the coast to New Jersey and come back again. They're very mobile, and they will travel north.
So it's a totally different group that might be up north.
Well, the ones in Maine, yeah. If you're seeing that, you don't see as many dolphins, you see more porpoises, hard porpoises than bottlenose dolphins. Yeah, bottlenose dolphins, I'd say good. Definitely from sort of New York and further south.
Yeah. How do the sightings correlate with the time of day?
So the sightings in terms of time of day, we did plot, the only thing is, I think it's partly a fact of when people are out, because we saw the peak in the sightings is sort of middle of the day to the early evening. Right. And so I don't know if that's more an artifact of the people than when the dolphins are there. It's interesting, with the acoustics you're sort of biased because they might be echoing more at night, and then with the sightings you're biased for when people are out.
I see.
So obviously, you know, we don't have sightings at 1 o'clock in the morning.
Right.
But
detector of some kind and put it on their docks on the boat?
The hydrophones.
Are you still doing that?
So we definitely are interested in that. So one thing that we have found, the more that we've done this now, is that our quick detector does struggle with shallow water, that there are other things that can get mistaken with dolphin sounds. It performs better in deep water. So if anyone has a dock or access to a location that's more like 3 meters or more deep, so 15 feet or so, that would be great, because we found if we do sort of 6 feet or less, it doesn't work as well. We have to spend a lot of time manually verifying the clicks, which we just don't really have the manpower to do. Yeah, thanks.
And my question's along the same lines. Are there sensors that we could get that we could drop in the water when we see it, or we record and send you the audio?
Yeah, so the seed pod, the click detector that we use, doesn't actually record the whole audio stream. So you can't sort of play it back, but it will just tell you when dolphins were detected. And that one is really easy to use. That is really nice. If you want to listen to the sound, yes, I mean, you can, they're still not super simple, but you can get either one that's cabled, that you could just sort of put over the side of your boat, but you need to, and you can have a box that can record it onto an SD card or something like that, so that's fairly easy to put over the side. If it's something that you're going to moor that you want to record the sounds, you can get those. The cabled ones now, it's amazing. You can get them for a couple of hundred dollars. Generally, the ones that you're going to moor and sort of leave out there for weeks or months, those are more like at least 3,000. So, if you're interested enough, you want to get a cabled hydrophone for a few hundred, though, that would certainly be really helpful. Yeah.
And your group would be interested in getting those
sound? Oh, definitely. Because if you have the sound recordings, then say we can then look for other signature whistles. We can verify, are there new dolphins or the dolphins that were getting detected again? We can detect feeding buzzes, so when the clicks are really close together, so when they're hunting a fish and they're click, we can detect that. So then even if you didn't see a fish at the surface, we can detect if they were feeding or not. So there's a lot of information beyond that we can get from the sounds beyond just the we know you saw dolphins at this location.
So is there a website you could recommend, or you've done the research on which actually work?
I don't know the name of the website off the top of my head, but if you contact our team, we can point you to those places. Yeah, definitely. And I have business cards I can put out back to book rack cards and business cards. Or you just write down this address.
Do sea collar crabs or any shellfish?
In one of the few studies that was done in the Atlantic on diet, it did indicate they could, but it wasn't a large portion of their diet. It was pretty small.
Where do you donate money for your cause?
If you go to this website, bbc.eu/shellfish, there's a donate button. So there you can donate to the project, which would be fantastic. Any donations we get, we're putting towards the sound monitoring so that we can deploy these devices and collect more information, because it's been just incredible to say how little was known about this, and even just within the last couple of years. And it's really made an impact, because NOAA, for the first time, is now requiring people who are doing activities that will make noise, potentially disturb dolphins, they're now requiring them to include that in environmental impact statements, which they never required in the Bay before. So it is really great to know that NOAA have listened and they are paying attention to it.
Yeah. How many baby dolphins are born every year, and has it been increasing?
That's a hard question to answer, because usually that would be answered with photo ID work, which is what Janet Mann does. She's been doing photo ID at the mouth of the Potomac, where we have that hydrophone. A number of babies have been sighted, only the one birth, but a number of babies have been sighted. But across the whole population, because there's only very few spots where this photo ID is being done, it's hard to know the total number of babies. But it's probably on the order of 10 to 100.
Yeah. Have you been able to tell from the different, you know, you said that you'd be all part of the same group, but in different areas. Have you been able to tell from your research whether groups over here might be chasing fish up to another group? Is there, like, cooperative?
Yeah, I mean, certainly that has been seen in some other places, the cooperative feeding. And I'm hoping my master's student, Lauren, that's one of the things she can start looking at. We really haven't dug into the feeding information yet, so I don't have an answer to that question yet.
That's
by next year.
And one other quick thing was, have you, now, I know your research has only been going on for, you know, maybe 4 or 5 years, can you say that you think that the health of the bay is bringing the dolphins?
Well, I mean, it is interesting because at the point that we were starting the project, funding for the bay program was under threat. And so certainly that, you know, we do not want to go backwards. We want to be having a healthier bay. And so we certainly want to encourage that. I mean, if there isn't fish, they're not going to come.
Right.
So we need to have healthy fish populations. And
I just remember reading sometimes about the dead zone or something in the bay.
Yes.
Which would decrease the number of fish, I would
say. Yeah, I mean, it is interesting because sometimes we will see predatory fish and potentially dolphins will feed at the edge of those, so the fish are trying to stay out of the really low oxygen areas, but they might still be physiologically less able to run away, that the predators can take advantage of that. But if the dead zone is big enough, then you just don't have as many fish and it's not as...
So the health of the bay has probably been bringing them back in here.
Yeah,
because
yeah, yeah.
I've seen how they're getting a better grade now, the bay.
And remember, it is a cycle. I mean, obviously these animals are feeding on fish, but they're also pooping out there as well. So they're sort of like the fertilizers too. So yeah, and as I say, they're very mobile. I mean, it's not like they're staying in the bay all summer and chomping on all the fish. I mean, they're coming in, they're feeding, they're going out. I mean, like a lot of natural predators, they have a pretty large range that they're
within a day, within 24 hours.
Within a day, yeah. I mean, they can travel up to 5 meters per second.
Sharks.
Yeah, bull sharks,
great
white sharks.
Maybe not so much in the bay,
but
it's
like well, because there was a massive bull shark reported on Cedar Point, and bull sharks definitely come into the bay. But yes, I mean, having a young here probably indicates, yeah, there might be fewer around than elsewhere. Yeah, because these sharks are definitely predate on that release, yeah. And then dolphins obviously will try and protect them. Adult dolphins are pretty powerful. I mean, they will fight back if a shark attacks them, and they will definitely try and protect their young. But yeah, sharks would be the main predator. In other locations, it could be killer whales, potentially, but not here. Sharks would be the main thing.
You had mentioned that you believe that the dolphins are leaving the bay and heading down off the coast of North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
Are you seeing that because of these identifying clicks are found in some other research down off North Carolina?
No, that's just based on the NOAA stock assessment reports of the population. So when they did this satellite tracking of some individuals, that's where they were seeing them go in the winter. There are Cornell University, who we collaborated with on the offshore project, they actually put hydrophones out in the Virginia wind energy area, so that is a possibility that we could work with them to look at dolphin signature whistles there. I don't know, I'm not quite sure anyone's looked at that in off North Carolina. A lot of the funding has been focused on North Atlantic right whales, which are low frequency, and so often to have as long a recording time as possible, researchers will only have the devices record at those low frequencies, and so then you can't pick out any of the dolphin sounds. So it's been a little more limited. We're one of the few groups that have focused on dolphins and porpoises.
Yeah, I just want to, we vacationed down in Hilton Head, and we took a little dolphin boat ride up in the harbor. Those would be completely different dolphins.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's also nice, a different population.
Different population, but now those might go farther south.
Well, so there are both some more migratory populations and some more resident populations. So depending on where you are, there are some areas with estuaries where they have sort of more resident populations that stay there year round versus other places where they're more migratory. Now, part of the reason up here they tend to be more migratory is because of the temperature that we get cooler, whereas as you go further south, they can always stand it year round. So that even if they are migratory, they may not be moving as far as they are here. Yeah, thank you. Well, I already need into the sea turtle time anymore than I have, so I don't know how it's coming. Yeah, thank you guys so much for having us. My name is Alice Fireman, and I am a master's student at the Chesapeake Biological Lab with Helen. I'm also a field director for the Jumpy Bay Hawksbill Project, which is a sea turtle research and monitoring project that's actually based in Antigua in the Caribbean. So I'm going to be talking to you guys about a species that lives a little bit further away from home than the dolphins in the bay. We're going to be talking about 33 years of tagging, tracking, and trends in the Caribbean hawksbill. So first I want to begin with a little bit about why we should care about sea turtles. Today there are 7 species of sea turtles that are swimming around in our oceans, and most of these species have been listed as endangered, critically endangered, or threatened. And what's a little bit more scary about that is that most of these species are also considered what we call a keystone species. That means that they are integral to maintaining healthy ecosystems. So that means that if, for example, the hawksbill sea turtle were to disappear from coral reefs, we would see a very rapid decline within coral reef ecosystems. They're also very important for tourism. We all know that people like to see sea turtles. If you are going to see a sea turtle on a dive, or while snorkeling, or even on a nesting beach, people will often pay more for these experiences. So sea turtles and big marine animals are generally important for economic purposes within the tourism industry. And then as a conservationist, it's also important to look at these species not just from an economical value, but also at sort of the intrinsic value of nature. They are endangered or threatened species, and they're fun to see. So we should be trying to conserve these species.
You didn't accidentally turn the mic off, did you?
Okay. Did I turn it off?
No,
So like I said, there are 7 species of sea turtles swimming around our ocean today. Some of them you might see in the Chesapeake Bay, but I'm not actually going to be talking about those today. You can see they range vastly in size. If you go to the next slide. Some of the ones that you might see in the Chesapeake Bay are the leatherback sea turtle. These guys are the largest species of sea turtle. You might see the loggerhead sea turtle or the green sea turtle. So these are some of the common ones you guys might be seeing if you're out on your boats in the Chesapeake Bay. But my area of interest is a little bit further away, like I said, in Antigua, working with a different species. The species I work with is called the hawksbill sea turtle. Now their scientific name is Arethmochelys imbricata, and they are so named because of their shell. So these segments, that you see on the shell are called scutes. And on the hawksbill, those scutes actually overlap like roof shingles. On different species of sea turtles, those scutes fit together more like a jigsaw puzzle. So that's one reason why they're called the imbricating scutes, because they overlay on top of each other. Their common name actually comes from their mouth or their bill shape. You can see the hawksbill has a very pointed, curved hook beak. It looks like a bird's beak, hence the name hawksbill. Now, the reason that they have this adaptation of that pointed, curved beak is that they're actually primarily spongivores. So what that means is they mostly eat sea sponges. It's kind of an odd diet. and they use that hooked curved beak to be able to eat these sea sponges off of coral rocky systems. So there are other kinds of sea turtles that have much flatter mouths. Those turtles would not be able to get into those little crevices on the rocks and the coral. These are one of the species that is actually critically endangered. That's only one step above extinct in the wild, so they really need our help in terms of conservation. One of the main reasons that they are critically endangered today is due to the tortoise shell industry. You guys can see how beautiful this tortoise shell is. Any real tortoise shell product, for the most part, would have come from the Hawksbill sea turtle back when it was legal to take and sell. Now, of course, it is illegal. They are a protected species. Unfortunately, it does still happen today. But while it's illegal for the most part now, the damage has been done. Some people believe that there's been decline overall globally in the population by about 90%. So it's a huge problem here. Now, one of the interesting things about hawksbills and sea turtles in general, but generally turtles that tend to migrate to nesting beaches on islands, is something called natal homing. What this means is that female sea turtles will always return to the same nesting beach when it's time for them to lay their eggs. And actually, what's even more interesting about this is that that beach is where they themselves were born. So if a turtle is born and hatched out of an egg and crawls down to the water in Barbados, and she survives 20 to 30 years, you can probably expect to see her back on that same beach to lay her own eggs. So because of this, they are critically endangered. We need to protect both land and sea habitats. They spend the vast majority of their lives swimming around in the water, and the males very rarely will ever leave the water. But then they also, the females, will utilize sandy beaches for nesting. Now these nesting beaches are actually ideal study and conservation sites, and that's because if you know that a sea turtle is going to be nesting on a beach, all you have to do is go there and they will come to you. You don't have to go out into the water and find them and spend a lot of money on equipment to go out and find them. So the project that I work for, the Jumpy Bay Hawksbill Project, is actually the longest continuously running hawksbill research project in the world. So it was founded in 1987 with the mission of hoping to conserve and monitor a population of female sea turtles, specifically hawksbills, that nest on this one beach on a small barrier island in Long Island, Antigua. Not Long Island, New York. So there's a little video here, I hope it works, just to show you guys the placement of where Antigua is. So if we start in Washington, D.C., I'm going to take you guys on a trip down to the Eastern Caribbean. It might not work, but that's okay because I have maps to show you after. Oh, here we go. Down to the beautiful island of Antigua. And if you go to the next slide, we'll zoom in a little bit further. So this is the main island of Antigua. We call it the mainland, but in reality, it's actually quite small to begin with and only takes about an hour to drive from the north to the southern part of the island. So it's very small. But we actually zoom in even further to Long Island here. Not Long Island, this is geological name. Jumpy Bay is like the commercial name, so they're kind of interchangeable. And then we zoom in onto this island, onto a small beach that's on the northern side of the island. It's called Pasture Beach. And this is where the vast majority of sea turtle nesting in Antigua actually happens. The density of nests here is pretty incredible. Within a 6-month nesting season, we'll typically see 200 to 300 nests, and it's a very small beach. So it's about 650 meters in length, which is a little bit less than half a mile. It takes about 15 minutes to walk from point to point around the edge of the beach, so it's very small. And typically we'll see about one nest about every 2 to 3 meters. So you can't like walk and not see a nest. So it's a pretty incredible spot. This is one of the highest density hawksbill beaches. in the Caribbean. So it's an important spot for study of these species. To give you guys a sense of what this work feels like, it's really beautiful. I'm often wondering, am I working on this field site or am I in paradise? It's gorgeous. So like I said, the mission of the Jumping Bay Hawks Build Project is twofold. The first part is monitoring of this population. In the late 80s, there wasn't that much known about the Hawksbill sea turtle, and so they set out to kind of try to understand some of the baseline, we call it life history, information about what these turtles are doing, how long they live, how many nests they lay. And so the way that we do that is through a method called saturation tagging. Now what that means is that every turtle that comes up onto the beach to lay a nest gets two tags in her front two flippers. These tags, they're actually just cattle tags. They have a unique number letter combination. It's her name tag. Every time she then returns to the beach, we can check these tags, see exactly who she is, and reference how old she is, how many eggs she's laid, how many nests she's laid, and start to understand more about the life history of these animals. And then in relation, obviously, to the monitoring, we then also are a conservation project as well. So we will do things like if a turtle is laying her nest too close to the high tide line, and we think that the eggs might become inundated with water, which would actually kill the nest, we will crawl behind the turtle and catch her eggs as she's laying them, put them in a bag, and then we'll move them higher up the beach to a spot where they most definitely will not get inundated with water. So we do a lot of conservation stuff like that as well to make sure that both the nesting females and the hatchlings that will come out 2 months later have the best chance of survival. So what has come from 33 years in walking this beach? I should also mention sea turtles nest at nighttime, so for 6 months, field researchers are totally nocturnal. We work every single night, so we don't get weekends off, so it's a lot of work, but it's also a lot of fun. So what has come from all of this work? We now have 33 years of data on how many turtles, how many individual turtles have nested on this one beach. So I'm going to break up these 33 years into three different sections for you guys to look at. On this graph here, I have the total number of individuals that have nested in 1 year in red, and then the total number along this axis here, and then we just have time moving forward through the year on the x-axis. And then the green represents re-migrant turtles. This means that a turtle has come back to the beach and she has tags. So we've seen her before, she's making another migration back to the nesting beach after having been tagged once before. And then in the blue, we have neophytes. This means that this is a first-time nesting turtle. So she's coming up to the beach and she has no identification, she's never been to the beach before, it's the first-time nesting. So you can see in the first 13 or so years of the project through the 90s, the population trends weren't really significant one way or the other. It generally stayed around 30. There were some bumps and spikes, but for the most part, there wasn't a big trend. Then as we move into the early 2000s, we start to get this lovely increase in turtles. So this is great, right? We see almost a threefold increase from an average of about 30 turtles all the way up to 2014, we had 90. So there was a threefold increase. Everyone's patting themselves on the back saying, this is a wonderful conservation success story. The Hawksbill is rebounding in Antigua. This is great. The unfortunate news is the last few years, we have seen a sharp decline in the number of nesting turtles. It's not a full like trend, you could say, because we did also still have one very good year in 2017, but overall we have seen that 3 out of the last 4 years have been almost all the way previous nesting numbers. So this has us scratching our heads a little bit. In 2016, the first year when we had that lower number, were thinking it was an anomaly, it was just a bad year. 2017, they were back up again and said, okay, everything's fine. But then, of course, in the last 2 years, we saw much, much lower numbers, and actually 2018 was a 15-year record low for us. So we have a couple of theories as to why we think there's been this sudden decline in nesting numbers. So the first one, our first hypothesis as to why this may be happening currently is coral reef decline. So hawksbills typically will nest every 2 to 4 years. So they don't nest in sequential years. So we'll see one turtle in 2018, and then we'll expect to see her again in 2020 or later. Now the reason that they do this is because they lay hundreds and hundreds of eggs every season. In 1 year, they'll lay average of about 5 nests, and each of those nests is going to have 130 to 150 on average eggs. It's a huge amount of eggs. It's a huge energy investment for them to go from their foraging grounds, where they typically live in the year, to migrate all the way to Antigua, lay all these eggs, and then migrate all the way back to their foraging grounds. So when they get back to their home, they have to eat really fast and really rapidly in order to restore themselves. Now that's easy if their foraging grounds are healthy and there are lots of sea sponges and different kinds of food available for them. But if they are returning to a foraging ground and all of a sudden the reefs have been bleached or dead and overgrown with things that they can't eat, it's going to be a lot harder for them to restore their body to be able to reproduce again. So what does that mean for the turtles? It means that they would be taking longer in between each nesting season. As you guys might remember, was 2017. Access to the nesting for the turtles might be familiar with sargassum seaweed, ringing a bell to some of you guys, or is it a little bit? So sargassum seaweed, it's actually a floating seaweed. You can see it floats right on top of the water here. It's kind of this like orangey brown color. And it's actually a really important habitat for a lot of small marine species. It's typically found in this area called the Sargasso Sea, which is in the Atlantic. But recently, we've been seeing it in different places. Mostly because of rising sea temperatures, increased nutrient inputs from the Amazon River Basin, and then changing ocean currents as well. So what's been happening is a new subspecies of this seaweed has been forming off the coast of Brazil. So if you think about all the nutrients that are being dumped into the ocean from the Amazon River Basin as deforestation happens, there's a lot more nutrients there where there didn't used to be. This seaweed is growing very rapidly, and it's creating, we call them mats, because they basically just sit on the surface of the ocean and they're huge. They can also go down into the water column, like meters. They're huge. If you were to like snorkel underneath one, you wouldn't see sunlight. So they're huge, and they are causing lots of disruptions in the Caribbean. Because the currents are bringing them from the coast of Brazil up north through the Caribbean and all the way into like the coasts of Miami, Florida. You can see it there too. But the Caribbean especially is getting hit really hard by these because of the seaweed will get trapped on coastlines. So it basically gets washed ashore and it just gets stuck. And it sits here and it rots and it smells really bad. It's really gross because we have to walk through this every night, so I'm very familiar with it. But to give you guys a sense, the coastline should be right here. This is where the water should be meeting the sand. Instead, you can see there's just this thick mat of rotting seaweed. It also turns the water brown as it starts to decay, so the whole, it's just gross. So if you can imagine, if you're a sea turtle out here, and this is your nesting habitat, it's not going to be easy for you to get through all of this stuff to get to your nesting ground. You can even see, if you look very closely, there are seagulls that will just sit on top of it because of how dense it is. So this is a huge issue in the Caribbean, and it could potentially be impacting the movements of our sea turtles to the nesting beach. If you go to the next slide, though, I will give a little a little reason why perhaps this isn't necessarily impacting our yearly nesting numbers. That's because, as you can see, Pasture Beach, it faces north and it's kind of a crescent-shaped beach. The way that the currents move is that water comes from the northeast and comes in this way. So it means that the sargassum will pile up along this shoreline, but the rest of the beach is usually protected from sargassum due to this small point here. So you can actually see, this is standing on this side of the beach. You can see there's actually a good amount of clear shoreline, but then the second half of the beach is gross. So there is still nesting habitat, and what we've been seeing in years where it looks like this was 2018, in years where it looks like this, we just get a higher density of nests on this side of the beach. Now that could still have a negative impact down the line for sea turtles, because female sea turtles don't know when there's a nest already in the ground. So a turtle could come up to the beach, start digging, and if she started digging into her sister's nest, she'd never know. She would dig up all the eggs and they would be ruined. And we see it every once in a while, and it's very sad. But if the turtles are restricted to a smaller area of beach, this is going to happen more frequently. And then the second part of this, of the second hypothesis with beach access, is coastal erosion. So we have seen huge, huge amounts of sand loss on our beach. We mostly think, you know, this is due to sea level rise. You can see the difference here. These are two different points along Pasture Beach compared between 2005 and 2019. You can see the huge difference in sand loss here. The vegetation line, you know, you've got a couple meters of sand here, versus here, the water is coming up underneath the vegetation. So they're just losing their habitat that they can nest on. Now, we're thinking if sand and beach access is potentially having negative effects on the turtles, that we might be seeing an increase in nesting in other areas nearby that perhaps don't have sargassum lining the shores, or perhaps are less impacted by sand erosion. However, we're not seeing that. We've been trying to monitor beaches around the island that aren't Pasture Beach to see if perhaps our turtles are saying, we don't like pasture anymore, we're gonna go around and nest on this side of the island. It's not happening. They're just not coming. So we're not 100% sure why yet, but I think it highlights the importance of long-term conservation monitoring efforts, that even after 15 years, we're still seeing different changes in how the population is going. So every year since 2016, we've been saying, well, next year will be really important to see if this is a trend or a couple years of anomaly. So it's important to continue monitoring this population. So that was a lot of doom and gloom, unfortunately. But I also want to talk to you guys about some of the other cool research that we are doing to contribute to conservation of the hawksbill sea turtle. So one of the main things that we have started doing in the last 5 years is actually satellite tracking some of these turtles. So what we're doing is we're tracking their in-water movements. There is a large amount of information on sea turtles in their reproductive habitats. Because what I was saying before, it's really easy to go out to these nesting beaches and they come right up to us and we can gain information on them by just buying some little tin or aluminum tags and putting them in and they come back and it's easy and cheap and we do it. It's harder to figure out what they're doing in the water. So one way that we've been doing this is putting out these tags on the shells of the turtle. So they're satellite transmitting tags. They're pretty small, they fit just in the palm of your hand. And we epoxy them onto the shell of the turtle, and then we'll paint them over with this beautiful blue paint that is an anti-fouling paint so that barnacles and stuff don't grow up and pop the tags off. And the way that they work, these two little white circles here, they're called saltwater switches. So when the turtle is swimming around in the water, the tags turn off. As soon as the turtle comes up to breathe, these tags are exposed to air. They turn on, send a signal to the satellite, and then we get the data on where she is. So it's nice because it saves the battery. We don't constantly get tag information. It only works when she comes up to surface. So we get a couple good points each day on where she is. So where are our turtles going? We know they're all nesting in Antigua. for the most part, they're all staying relatively close to Antigua. We actually have four turtles that are basically local to Antigua. They migrated just off the western coast of Antigua proper, so they're not making very long migrations. But then we do have three turtles with very long migrations all the way through the Caribbean. You can see this turtle migrated all the way off the coast of Nicaragua. We have another turtle that's in a similar area, and then we have one turtle that migrated all the way up to the Bahamas. So there's kind of a mixture here in terms of migratory areas. We know the population is genetically distinct, so they are all mating with each other and mating and breeding in the same area of Antigua, but then they return to different foraging habitats. So with this information, we can determine the exact location with an error of about a kilometer. So if you saw a point, you couldn't get out on your boat and kind of go find it. It might be a little bit hard. But exact location and timing of where these turtles are going. So it's really good baseline information. We can say, okay, in between her nests, we know she's staying in a clustered area around Antigua. She's then making this migration along through these island chains, and then we know this is her foraging ground. So this is really good information that we can use with local governments to say, hey, we need to be protecting these waters, because even if we protect this area around the Nesting Beach, and we protect the area around her foraging ground, there's still this long migration that leaves her vulnerable to in-water pressures like fishing or boat striking trees. So it provides really good baseline information. However, it's very expensive. And as you guys might know, there isn't that much money in conservation science, unfortunately. It's also pretty labor intensive. It takes about 2 to 3 hours of work with the turtle on the beach to actually apply this tag to her. So you have to wait for the epoxy to dry, you have to wait for the paint to dry. So it's stressful for the turtle, it's very stressful for us. And then it also has kind of a big price tag. It's about $1,500 for one tag. You also have to pay for 6 months of data fees. But it's like high risk, high reward. If you apply the tag correctly and it's data on, you get really good locational data, but there's also a high risk that $1,500 could end up at the bottom of the ocean if the tag doesn't work properly. And we actually, of the 23 tags that we've put out, two of them, one had battery failure within the first month, so it just turned off and we stopped getting locational data. And the second one fell off the turtle. The turtle came back up its nest and the tag was not there. That was our first year. We learned and changed. We changed our epoxy and changed a couple things, and we've had 100% tag success rate since then. But so in science, we're always looking for new innovative ways to cut down on costs, cut down on labor, to try to make some of the same inferences. So I'm going to tell you guys about specifically my master's research using a technique called stable isotope analysis. It basically works on the theory that you are what you eat. So stable isotopes in tissue, I like this phrase, they're like forensic reporters of behavior. So it's using chemical tracers within an organism to try to understand what that animal has been eating and doing in her past life. So I'm going to walk you guys through a very basic thing that some of you probably know already, but the food chain. If you think about the elements that are stored in things like seagrasses and algae, little bits of plants out in the water, how they move through the food web. So let's say there are these little red element dots. They are going to move to the plankton that eat the plants. These same elements are then going to be moved as fish eat the plankton, and then of course we'll move all the way up to like a big shark, an apex predator. So you can just a good visual to see how these things are moving through the food chain. So if you were to take a little piece of tissue from this shark, like a little skin cell or something like that, you would be looking at the same material from where it came from all the way at the base of the food web. So how does this apply to turtles? So typically, when we're using stable isotope analysis or chemical tracers in animals, we look at carbon and nitrogen isotopes. Now, carbon can tell you generally the location of where an animal has been eating, and nitrogen can tell you the level of the food chain. Now, sea turtles I like to think of them as ideal candidates for this kind of analysis. And that's because they're migratory with distinct life stages. So if we're looking at the differences in what a turtle has been doing or eating over the course of her life, there might be distinct changes in that record. On top of that, we also have good baseline information on their diet already. We generally know that hawksbills tend to eat mostly sponges. We do know that they eat other things sometimes, but this is sort of good baseline information that we know about them. And then the most interesting thing, I think, about turtles is that the outer layer of their shell is actually made of keratin. So that's what your fingernails and your hair is made out of, but it's really thick. So if you can imagine your fingernail, that's like 2 to 6 millimeters thick. That's what's covering the outside of the turtle. Now what this means is that if you think about how your fingernails grow, if you were to take a small sample from the edge of your fingernail, that was grown on your body a month ago or a couple weeks ago. Whereas the part of your fingernail down by the nail bed, that's gonna be more recent growth. So if you were eating only cheeseburgers a month ago, you might be able to see that in your fingernail, versus if you decided to eat mostly salads, that might show on your fingernail. So we can kind of see in turtles, because they have such thin layers of keratin, some people actually predict that in some species, that outermost layer of keratin was grown on the turtle around 15 years ago. So you have a huge amount of information that's just stored on their shells to begin with. So what I have been doing, on each turtle that comes up to nest when we're collecting our data, I sample a piece of the keratin from 2 spots on the shell. When they come out, they look kind of like a layer cake. They're only about this big, they're only 1/4 inch in diameter, and like I said, 2 to 6 millimeters thick. And what you can see is these different layers within the keratin plugs. So this is a zoomed in image under a microscope of what the keratin sections look like. So you can think of these growth lines here, you can see these are very clear. You can think of them like tree rings. They're basically indicating different layers of growth within the turtle's history. So what you can do is if you shave off this first layer, that's going to tell you something about what the turtle was doing, let's say, 10 years ago. You can then shave off the second layer, and that's going to tell you what the turtle was doing 8 years ago, and then 6, and so on until you get to the end of the layer, which is the newest growth. So you homogenize this tissue, you make it into a fine powder, and you can analyze it for nitrogen and carbon and start to make inferences about what the turtle was doing throughout her life. So I have some very preliminary results about what I've been seeing so far. I do want to mention though, I have a very small sample set, but now I've only analyzed 5 turtles. More to come soon then. So what we're looking at here, each of these lines indicates 1 turtle. We have time on the bottom here, so, or we can think of this as distance from the surface on those keratin plugs. So while we can't timestamp them exactly, we can say maybe this was 15 years ago, 10, 5 years ago. And then we're looking at carbon and nitrogen values here. So what's the first thing that I see when I look at this is that the nitrogen values are kind of all over the place, right? This turtle is way down here, this turtle's all the way up here. So even between turtles, there's a lot of variation. And then within turtles as well. So this green turtle is up and down, and then up and down, and up and down. So what does that mean? We're seeing lots of variation, both within and between turtles. It means that they are probably eating different things at different stages in their lives. Now, what kind of inferences can we make about coral reefs, about their habitats that we know are threatened right now? If you think 1 year, perhaps a turtle sees a lot of sponges, and she can eat a lot of sponges that year. Perhaps the next year, the coral reef is not doing so well, and all of a sudden there's a lot of algae there, so she's going to eat more of the algae. And then the next year, maybe it's a little bit better, so she goes back and eats something else, and something else, and something else. It means there's a lot of fluctuation potentially happening in this ecosystem, so it's not stable. Generally, if you're thinking about an organism but is constantly surrounded by like the most nutritional food they could eat. Like if you are always put, a meal is put in front of you that has like a vegetable, a grain, and a protein, and you don't have to look for anything else, and you don't have like a preference for Doritos or something like that, you're gonna eat the meal that's good for you, instead of trying to eat something else. So if we're seeing animals that are eating a lot of different things, it could indicate that they're eating opportunistically in a threatened ecosystem. Now again, this lines up with what we're seeing, a decline in nesting numbers. We know that Caribbean coral reefs are not doing so well. So this all does kind of fit into this big picture of reef decline. So it's unfortunate, but I will also just say once again, there's only 5 turtles. There's more work to come before I can start to really make big differences about what this stuff means. So I'm just going to bring it back around about the larger picture again. Why should we care about this again? Changing climate decreases in nesting numbers, outcrop spills, and variable foraging turtle strategy all point to this declining coral reef health. And what does this mean is that protection of marine habitats are going to be critical for both coral reef diversity, but also the fate of the hawksbill sea turtle. So I want to thank a lot of people. Obviously, the Jimmy Bay Hawksbill Project has been in operation for 33 years. I've only been working there for 4 years, so there are a lot of people that came before me that collected a lot of this data. I also specifically want to thank, though, Andy Maurer and Kate Levaster, and Higby Goodwin, who have all collected and helped in this process. Brian Woodland, my assistant advisor, and Seth Stapleton, who is the project director for the Jimmy Bay Hawksbill Project, and then some of my funding sources as well. So thank you guys if you have questions, if you're happy to take them now.
The tracking devices, you know, that bigger blue thing. Is there a reason that that's not sort of painted the color of the shell? Is that blue more attractive to predators, to the turtle?
So for the most part, turtles don't interact that much with other predators. Sometimes a large shark might be able to snag a bite of one, but their size is very helpful to them. So we're not very concerned that that the color could be like helping them, helping a shark. It was just the color that we were given by the hardware store, Antigua.
What kicks off the next layer of shell? So it's annually or is it 5 years?
That is a question that I don't have the answer to. People have used stable isotope analysis with other species of turtles. With like loggerhead sea turtles and green sea turtles, so ones that we're seeing in the bay. And so with those turtles, they've been able to determine what the growth layers mean in terms of aging them. It hasn't been done with hawksbills before. So TBD, maybe it'll be a paper in the next few years, but we don't know right now.
You were saying that they go back to the beach where they were born. When we lived in Florida, you know, they would take the nests from like down in Fort Lauderdale and then move them up to a more secluded beach. Is it like a long range? So if that turtle were hatched down in Fort Lauderdale, but they moved it back up to like Pompano or something, does it go back to Pompano when it's hatched there, or?
That's a great question. Typically, I think with loggerheads on the eastern coast of the U.S., they tend to have sort of a larger range of where they might be nesting. So a loggerhead that nests in Georgia one year might be seen in Florida the other year. And that's because they have a wide stretch of coastline that is available to them. We see a big difference with turtles that are nesting on islands, because if they like miss the island, they're not going to hit land, whereas if a turtle is just a little bit north in the U.S., they're still going to hit a nesting beach.
So it's not necessarily that exact beach with turtles in Florida, but it's in that area. Because
yeah.
I think salmon go back to the same river, I believe, but yeah. I don't know.
Yeah. So there's a little bit of a difference in terms of behavior when turtles are returning to islands, which are much more narrow, versus like the east coast of the U.S.
Mm-hmm.
You said you moved some of the eggs if they're threatened by high water. If that beach is also threatened by the Sargassum Sea and the erosion, could you put those eggs on another beach on that island?
We could. In terms of Jumpy Bay as an island, there are a number of developments, as in a resort and a number of houses on the island. So Pasture Beach generally tends to be like the most protected area. It also has the most natural vegetation that provides good cover for hostels. Hostels are a little weird in that they do like to nest under vegetation. Most other sea turtle species, if you see them, are actually nesting in open sand. So we think that one of the reasons that they like to come to Pasture Beach is because there's a lot of natural vegetation there. So it tends to be the best spot for nests.
You're taking the the shell sample and you're looking at the nitrogen and oxygen. Are these on the GPS cameras?
So I've been taking samples from basically every turtle that nests, of the 50 to 90 turtles that we get each year. We've put out about 5 in the last 5 years. So yeah, the turtles that have the GPS data for will be able to pair some of that isotope analysis. An interesting thing with that is also going to be looking at foraging strategy. So all of the turtles that I had up here for the most part were variable. They looked like they were kind of generalist feeders. But if we also get more turtles that look like they're more specialist turtles that are eating only one thing, it'll be really interesting to compare if all of the specialist turtles are coming from the same areas or if some of the ones that are more generous are coming from different areas. So, yeah, there's a lot on there.
Your focus is mostly on females. How do you track the male? Are you able to get it?
it's actually a topic that's discussed a lot in the sea turtle world, that there is a lack of knowledge on what the males are doing. We have a huge amount of information on what the females are doing because we see them on the nesting beach, but yeah, there's less information on the males. Currently in Antigua, we're not doing anything with the males right now. We just don't have those projects right now, but there are places around the world that are trying to focus more on male sea turtles.
I mean, because it could be that the male population dropped and they're not mating. But.
Yeah, that's part of it. And actually, if you guys are familiar at all with some sea turtle reproductive physiology, the eggs of the turtles, when they are laid, they actually don't have a sex. They're not determined the same way that ours are genetically. The sex of the turtle is determined during, in hospitals, in the middle 20 days of incubation. So they incubate for about 60 days, and in the middle 20 days, the sex of the turtle is determined based on the temperature of the nest. So a hotter nest is going to have proportionally more females, and a cooler nest is going to have proportionally more males. So that's actually an issue that a lot of people are thinking about as global temperatures continue to increase. We're having probably more and more females coming out of the nest. How is that going to impact sex ratios in the water and eventually long-term population trends?
That's interesting.
It's with a lot of reptiles.
Do you share data with other study groups around the world?
Yeah. So the Jumpy Bay Hospital Project is part of a collaborative group called YCAST, the Wider Caribbean Sea Turtle Network. So I'm actually next week, hopefully, unless coronavirus stops me, heading down to Colombia to present basically the same results to a group of Caribbean sea turtle researchers.
Because we spent a little bit of time with a group in Northern Cyprus. I think it was a study group out of the UK. And that was very interesting. We spent some time with them overnight releasing little tiny babies out, to get them off the beach. Because what was happening there is they built a lot of hotels and things around. And so when the babies hatched out, instead of heading to the sea, they were heading to the light of the hotels.
Oh, wow.
And so they were capturing all the young ones, bringing them back in, and then we would go down overnight and release them out to the ocean to give them a sort of start.
So that's also something that we work with. That goes back to your question about why Pasture Beach specifically. There are 2 or 3 homes that are situated along Pasture Beach, and all the people that live there know about the sea turtles, and they know to keep their lights off, and they're very respectful of the turtle situation. So we generally don't tend to see problems with the turtles going the wrong way because they're very attracted to light. But if it does happen, we're out there to collect them and put them back in the water.
And the other thing is that if they got them into the sea, their survival rate is much higher because a lot of them would be killed, you know, trying to get off the beach. And they also said, I think, only one, they bet one survive out of every 400 to 500 eggs.
The number we always toss around is 1 in 1,000.
1 in 1,000,
okay. It varies a lot based on population.
Yeah. It may be different areas.
Yes, definitely. So it's very low survival rate. But if you think about it, you know, these little turtles, since the beginning of turtle species, they've been dealing with natural predators like birds and crabs and things that are eating them. Unfortunately, now the reasons that they are critically endangered is due to human impact. The survival rate of the hatchlings has kind of always been low, but it's getting lower and lower to get into their environments.
These turtles are monogamous. They find like a reduction in males or something.
And there's actually a lot of competition between males as well. One interesting thing that has been found, specifically on our beach too, actually this woman here, Kate Labaster, does a lot of genetic work with our turtles. She's actually found that within one clutch of eggs, so one nest, eggs from the same mother can have different fathers.
Oh, interesting.
So
oh,
wow. Have you noticed any of the turtles with that photofluorescence, you know, hawksbill turtles can get shiny, neon greenish, like shells, et cetera, on Wikipedia?
I've never seen that, unfortunately, but I've seen the video. It's pretty amazing of the turtle with the We do get little bits of like bioluminescent algae that will float up onto the beach, but never on the turtle.